Good morning. Welcome here. Welcome to church. This morning we're going to start with a song we've done before. It's called You Are Holy, or Prince of Peace. And the chorus splits, so the men are singing one part and the women are singing another part. So to help clear up some of the confusion, we're going to sing the men's part first, then we'll sing the women's part, and then we'll start from the start. And then everyone knows what we're doing. Could you go to the next slide? Yeah. Was it on the right one?
Yeah.
So that was the men's part. So when we get into the chorus, men, you're going to follow Elliot. And now we're going to go through the women's part. There's a lot of words, so remember to breathe, ladies. Okay.
You are Lord of Lords, you are King of Kings, you are mighty God, Lord of everything, you're Emmanuel, you're the great I Am, you're the Prince of Peace, who is the Lamb, you're the living God, you're my saving grace, you will reign forever, you are Ancient of Days, you are Alpha, Omega, beginning and end, you're my Savior, Messiah, Redeemer and Friend, you're my Prince of Peace, and I will live my life for you.
Here we go. You are whole. Well done. Here we go. You are holy.
You are holy.
You are mighty.
You are mighty.
You are worthy.
You are worthy.
Worthy of praise.
Worthy of praise.
I will follow.
I will follow.
I will live. To and worship the King who
Prince of Peace, and I will live my life for you. And you're my Prince of Peace, and I will live my life for you.
Thank you. You can take a seat.
Okay, come on. Good morning. All right, that's what I like to hear. Good to see you all today. Man, bigger crowd than last week. So I'm glad the weather's warmed up and glad you're all here. Wonderful. Just to get us into our worship this morning, read from Psalm chapter 77, verses 1 to 15. That's our welcome to worship. It says this: I cried out to God for help. I cried out to God to hear me. When I was in distress, I sought the Lord. At night, I stretched out untiring hands, and I would not be comforted. I remembered you, God, and I groaned. I meditated, and my spirit grew faint. You kept my eyes from closing. I was too troubled to speak. I thought about the former days, the years of long ago. I remembered my songs in the night. My heart meditated, and my spirit asked, will the Lord reject forever? Will he never show his favor again? Has his unfailing love vanished forever? Has his promise failed for all time? Has God forgotten to be merciful? Has he in anger withheld his compassion? And then I thought, to this I will appeal. The years when the Most High stretched out his right hand, I will remember the deeds of the Lord. Yes, I will remember your miracles. Long ago, I will consider all your works and meditate on all your mighty deeds. Your ways, God, are holy. What God is as great as our God? You are the God who performs miracles. You display your power among the peoples. And with your mighty arm, you redeemed your people. Amen. That would be our reminder today. No matter where we are, no matter what we are going through, even if we feel like we're far from God or that he is far from us, remember our God who performs miracles, the one who has kept us, who has redeemed us from long ago. We have everything we need right in here to remind us of that. So today, let's give our God praise for who he is and what he has done. Just a few announcements as we get in. Again, you know, there wasn't very many people here last week, so I'm going through most of the announcements that we did last week. Our nursery and our quiet playroom are finished. Renovations are done. So, yeah. Amen. So thank you, Wade, and thank you, Carl, for putting in so much hard work these last couple weeks, and everybody else that helped as well to get that up and running. For, if you don't know, there's a nursery. The nursery's been moved downstairs. There's signs to direct you down the stairs. And if you turn around the corner, past the bathrooms, it is technically classroom number one, has been turned into the nursery. And so there are cribs and sleeping space down there. So if there's a somebody with a young baby that comes into our church visiting, feel free to direct them there as well. We also installed a change table inside the bathroom upstairs here. So just to be aware of that. Exciting. Conquer Series started this week. If you are still interested, feel free to come out and join us for the next few weeks as well. If you missed last week, that's okay. We can catch you up. Coming up, We had a meeting to discuss prayer, as we announced. An idea that we had discussed was coming up with, we're planning and we're hoping for this to come to fruition. And so this is what you can be in prayer for over the weeks ahead, is we're planning to start a community soup night. My goal, my desire is to have to start a monthly time of prayer for our church, an actual dedicated prayer meeting. And what better way to do that is around soup. And then what a better way to do that as well in making this dipping twice, I guess, out of this is we're going to actually use this as an outreach event as well to Rolla. And so we're looking at, Brenda is looking at securing the hall for us to come, and we're going to host a community soup night. And that's what we're going to advertise it as to the community. Anyone is free to come and come and get soup, and then they are welcome to stay. There's no pressure to, we're just going to, after a time of eating, we're just going to move into a time of gather together for our prayer meeting and use that as an opportunity just to invite people to join us in prayer if they want, invite them to share prayer requests if they want, and to be able to see us as God's visible light here in this community. And so that is our desire for this. We don't have a date set as for when the first one will take place, but if you're interested in making soup, make sure you talk with Karen and Brenda. And if you're interested in helping with that in any way, that would be wonderful. And this is something that I would like us all to get involved in and to be, to outreach into our community, to build relationships with the people in Rolla and let them see who you are. I mean, as people that come and attend this church regularly, let's be a light to our town here, because there's a lot of people that need Jesus. And so that is our plan, and we'll just advertise it here as soup and prayer, because that will be our monthly prayer meeting together. So, exciting. I'm excited. So pray that everything falls into place at this time. Any other announcements? I was supposed to make a mention for Becky. The ladies, Prayer and Share, have set up. Becky's trying to get people to sign up for prayer partners. So if you want somebody that you can reach out to, ladies, as far as having a partner that you can share your prayer requests with and develop a relationship with over this year, feel free to sign up for a prayer partner out there in the lobby on the sign-up sheet. Any other announcements? All righty. Well, yes.
For your soup and prayer night, are you hoping to get one from January, or the first one be February?
The first one will probably be in February, is what we're looking at. Yeah, a little soup. But it will probably be, we're looking at maybe around the start of February. Yes. I have not yet put a cleaning list. That will be also coming up. So I've been advertising in the Rolla Rundown, sign up for cleaning, and I have remembered that I also said that I was going to make the cleaning list, the sign-up sheet. So I will do that this week, next week. If you are willing to sign up to clean the church for a month at a time, for 4 or 5 weeks, and volunteer time that way, that would be greatly appreciated. Thank you to everybody this last year who has put in so much hard work in that as well. So that will be coming. Make sure it'll be ready this week for you to sign up. So thank you. Anything else? All right. I'm going to invite our ushers up to take the offering. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for, God, for your love. God, for your word. And to remind us, God, even in the darkest of times, God, we can be reminded of your work here in our lives, of your work in our lives 2,000 years ago through Jesus. And we can be reminded, we can even just look, God, to see what you are doing in our lives today. We thank you for just forgiving to us so richly and so generously. Lord, help us to give in the same way in return. We just thank you, God, for all that you have provided. And God, may this be a blessing to you and your ministry here. In your name, amen.
you could join us to sing a few more songs.
Jesus, our Savior. I believe in God, our Father. I believe in Christ, the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name. Our judge and our defender suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious light. Forever seated high. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe. I believe in life eternal. I believe in the virgin birth. I believe in the saints' communion and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection when Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is the name. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love.
Thank you. You can have a seat.
Wow. We're going to move into our time of prayer now. Over the last few weeks, we have started praying through a list of the different churches in our area, trying to take some time to just lift up the other congregations and the other believers in our area. And so this week, we were praying for Bethel Pentecostal Church and for Pastor Jared, and we can just be in prayer for them as they prepare as well. They have hired a new associate pastor, which I know is just an answer to prayer for Jared and what they're doing there. And so we can pray for Steve Peterson and his family as they are preparing. I don't believe they're here yet, but they are preparing to move up here, and so we can be in prayer. Prayer for Bethel as they prepare for a new associate pastor, and just a praise, an answer to prayer for them as well. We've also been praying these last couple weeks for Greg Broberg, who's the pastor of Peace Reform Presbyterian Church. Just this last week, was it Friday or Thursday? Greg passed away, and so we can be in prayer for his wife Lynn and for their church as well. Are there any other prayer requests this morning? That's for Dave and Barbara's son-in-law, Brant, for his salvation. Pray for Wilma, as she is just dealing with a bit of an infection while she's at Pure BI right now, and just that the healing takes place, and then as well for Dave's brother, Glenn, as well. Any other prayer requests? George. Any other prayer requests? Kira. Any others? Karen. Can you repeat that last part again? Okay. Yeah, we can pray for Phil and Margaret. Let's go to prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this time together as your church family here in Rolla. Lord, we pray, or we want to just lift up Bethel to you today as one of our sister churches here in this area. God, we just pray your blessing over them and their congregation. We pray for your blessing over Jared and his ministry there. Lord, we just thank you for this answer to prayer, this praise that we just get to bring you in answering their prayers for a new associate pastor. And so, Lord, I just pray. God, as Steve and his family prepare to move their lives from Logan Lake all the way up here to Dawson Creek, Lord, I just pray that you would continue to just give them peace in this decision. And clarity as they move forward, and God, that you would just be, you just have your hand in preparing their congregation and preparing their family just for this time of coming together and just learning each other and growing in relationship with one another. And so, Lord, I just pray for your abundant grace for their congregation, for Steve and his family as they prepare to come. Lord, we pray as well for Peace Reform, that you would be with them as they mourn the loss of Greg. Lord, we pray that you would be with Lynn and the rest of their family and their kids as they mourn and grieve the loss of their loved one. Lord, grant them your comfort and your peace in this time. And Lord, we just pray that you would in this time that you would just give their little church this direction, Lord, that you would just provide for all of the needs that they have moving forward. God, that they wouldn't feel the weight of this loss too much, Lord. Lord, be with them, we pray. Lord, we thank you for all of those that you put in our lives. all those you put in our family. Lord, we pray for the salvation of our loved ones. We think of Brant and in the Peachy family. Lord, we just pray, God, for his salvation above all. Lord, we just pray that you would be able to continue to use their family to be your light in his life. And Lord, that you would just also put others in his life that God would just point him towards you continually. Lord, we pray for Glenn as well, that you would just be with him and all of the vices that he faces. Lord, we ask for him to turn to you, to look to you, Lord, and to surrender above all his life to you, that you would just do a work in his life in transforming him from death to life, we pray. God, we pray for healing as well. We pray for Wilma as she is at school and dealing with this infection. Lord, we just pray your healing over her and her body, that this would clear up. God, that the treatments that the doctors are giving her would be working and quickly. And Lord, that you just grant her your peace through this time as well. Be with Cal, we pray, as he is in Prince George, God, getting radiation done. Lord, we don't know if he has any friends or relatives or relationships with people in Prince George during this time for people to come and visit him. But Lord, we just pray that you would sustain him during this time. Lord, just you continue to grant healing to his body as well, we pray. Lord, we pray for Kathleen. We pray that you would just be with her in the midst of these difficult decisions. God, grant her clarity. God, that she would be able to move forward. God, with your will, to seek your will, and that it would be done on earth as it is in heaven. Lord, we pray that you'd also just be with Phil and Margaret during this time as well. God, that you would, God, just lift them up, we pray. And Lord, we pray for Kiera's concern for her students. Lord, these children that are in unsafe homes. And Lord, just the difficulties that this cold snap has had in forcing people to be together and sometimes in unsafe situations and in difficult relationships. And Lord, we just pray, God, for your love and your protection on each of these children. And Lord, that we would not face another cold snap like this where the kids would have to face this again for this time. Lord, above all, we just pray for your salvation for this world. For those of us around us, our neighbors, we pray for those here in Rolla. God, that we would be your light here. God, that we would be able to build relationships, that people would come into our contact, God, and that we would be able to tell them about you. God, that we, by our actions, we would display, God, your work here, your wonderful work, God, that we can cling to. We thank you, God, for your love and your name. Amen. Well, this week we're continuing in our new series, The Spirit of Elijah. Last week we began our series starting off in 1 Kings chapter 17. We are looking at the person and the work of the prophet Elijah. And just some of you have been handing some of these papers out here and there. I found a fun thing with my Bible study software that I can make word searches out of our passages. So each week I'm printing off about 10 or 15 word searches. So if you really want to go through the passage that we're going through, there's some word searches sitting out on the counter as well. You can can go through that as well. But our goals for this series, as we are digging into the life of Elijah, are to better understand how Elijah fits into the greater narrative of the Bible. He's a pretty important guy that we find out. In Scripture, we see that he performs many miracles in his lifetime. And he was actually ends up being the second person in Scripture recorded to not have died, to have ascended into heaven without dying a physical death. And he wasn't just important during his time here on earth, but following his ascension into heaven, Elisha, his apprentice, asks for a double portion of his spirit. And his spirit passes on to Elisha as Elijah ascends to heaven. And at the end of Malachi, Elijah is prophesied to return, bringing a message of reconciliation and repentance. And then it would then be attested in the Gospels that John the Baptist was this person, given the spirit of Elijah, and thus fulfilling that prophecy. And then the Israelites of Jesus' time, they were waiting. They were looking forward to and watching for the return of Elijah. This was a significant thing. He was a significant guy. Elijah is even seen by the disciples with Jesus and Moses at Jesus' transfiguration on the mountain, following the significance of his position as the placeholder of both Moses and Jesus in the middle of Scripture. We discovered that last week, that he's Elijah's place. He's pointing Israel back, to following God with the covenant that they had made with him, but also pointing forward in many ways to Jesus and what was to come. And so last week, as we started our time with Elijah, we laid out the scene that Elijah finds himself in within this moment of history. Israel is divided into two kingdoms, the southern kingdom of Judah and the northern kingdom of Israel. And Elijah, he goes to speak with King Ahab. He's the king of Israel, what would become Samaria. And he tells him this very distressing message, that there is going to be no dew, there's going to be no rain in Israel the next few years until Elijah says that there will be rain. Feels a little bit like this summer. King Ahab was the most wicked, the most evil of all the kings in the history of Israel. And he also married the most wicked, evil woman recorded in the Bible, Jezebel. And together they killed hundreds of the Lord's prophets. And they turned Israel to following after Baal. They turned them away from Yahweh. And they turned Israel towards following Baal, making altars and houses for Baal worship. And we learned last week that Baal, this god that they served, he was known as the god of rain, the rider of the clouds. And Elijah goes and he hits them where it hurt most, showing them that Baal had no power. No power over the rain, no power over life. That Yahweh was the one with control over rain and life itself. And so famine comes on the land, and God tells Elijah to go hide. You know, Ahab and Jezebel, they're not entirely favorable to the Lord's prophets. And so God tells him to go and hide. And God feeds Elijah with meat and bread brought to him by ravens. And then, as the brook dries up where he is hiding, God tells him to go northwest into the neighboring nation of Phoenicia, to the region of Sidon in the town of Zarephath. It's there where God provides Elijah with a place to stay with a widow and her family. And it's there that God provides also the widow and her family with unending flour and oil so that they could survive this famine. And this week we'll be completing our time in chapter 17 and Elijah's time with the widow in Zarephath. The question, though, I want us to begin pondering this morning is, as we go through our passage, is how big of a miracle or sign from God do you need to convince you of his work or provision in your life? How big of a miracle do you need to really convince you of God's work in your life? I don't mean just to convince you that he's real, though maybe that might be where some of us are at here. But even for those of us who have given our lives to Christ, sometimes we can fall into an attitude of expecting God to show us some kind of sign so that we know he's still with us. We know he's still working. Now, just like the psalmist writing this morning that we read in chapter 77. How big of a sign do you need from God to convince you that he is actually there at work? Well, if you have your Bibles with you this morning, I would invite you to please join with me in turning to 1 Kings chapter 17, verses 17 to 24. After I finish reading our passage, I'm going to say, "This is the word of the Lord," and I will ask you to respond in saying, "Thanks be to God." So here, 1 Kings chapter 17, starting in verse 17. We'll read this. "Sometime later, the son of the woman who owned the house became ill, and he grew worse and worse, and finally stopped breathing. And she said to Elijah, 'What do you have against me, man of God? Did you come to remind me of my sin and kill my son?' 'Give me your son,' Elijah replied. He took him from her arms, carried him to the upper room where he was staying, and laid him on the bed. And then he cried out to the Lord, 'Lord my God, have you brought tragedy even on this widow I am staying with by causing her son to die?' And then he stretched himself out on the boy three times and cried out to the Lord, 'Lord my God, let this boy's life return to him.' Lord heard Elijah's cry, and the boy's life returned to him, and he lived. And Elijah picked up the child and carried him down from the room into the house, and he gave him to his mother and said, 'Look, your son is alive.' And then the woman said to Elijah, 'Now I know that you are a man of God, and that the word of the Lord from your mouth is the truth.'" This is the word of the Lord. Well, the widow that Elijah is staying with, if we look back, she's already gone through, I would argue, quite a lot. When Elijah came to her in Zarephath, she was collecting sticks to make her last fire so that she could make her last loaf of bread that they had left and then go through the process of watching one another die of starvation. That was what she had just gone through. When we're first introduced to her, she's already gone through this horrible process of coming to terms with facing death along with her son. But by God's grace, he does what? He provides her with never-ending flour and oil. In a time of great famine and drought, they continually had food to eat. And Elijah showed up and told her that her flour and oil would not run out, and they had food. As verse 16 said, "For the jar of flour was not used up, and the jug of oil did not run dry, in keeping with the word of the Lord spoken by Elijah." And now it is sometime later. How long that is, we don't know, but they were still pouring out from these continually filled jars. She's still continually witnessing this miracle. But unfortunately, her son gets sick, and he gets worse and worse. We see he finally dies. And now this widow, she's grief-stricken. Like, who wouldn't be? She's just lost her son, the last of her family, and she ends up blaming it on Elijah. Takes it out on him. She says, "What have you against me?" Or it might be translated as, "What do I have to do with you? What do I have to do with you?" Forgetting that Elijah's presence, you know, had actually, in him coming, had actually already brought her and her son life. As they were both preparing to die, she points the blame at Elijah. "What do I have to do with you? Why did you come here? We were just minding our own business, just going along with our lives, and now here you are, trying to punish me for the sin in my life by killing my son. What do I have to do with you? She refers to him as man of God. What do I have to do with you? This death is being attributed, not just to Elijah, but to God also for the sin in her life. The title, man of God, it wasn't given out lightly in these days. A man of God was a divine messenger, someone who spoke with divine authority. And despite the provision of food and the life that came with Elijah's presence in her house, in this moment, she is viewing this Hebrew foreigner as one who's not benevolent, not kind-hearted towards those outside of Israel. But Elijah does not respond along the lines of the widow's thought and accusation. Elijah takes the child to the upper room. He begins crying out to the Lord, praying, pleading to the Lord for the boy's life. And as he's crying to the Lord, he stretches himself out over the boy three times and prays, "Lord my God, let this boy's life return to him." This is the first of two accounts of raising someone from the dead that we see in the spirit of Elijah. As we already said, Elisha, the servant of Elijah that receives Elijah's spirit after Elijah's taken up to heaven, also has the same similar account in raising a child to life. The child of the Shunammite son, of the Shunammite woman. And his story is recorded in 2 Kings chapter 4. And it contains the same miracle, actually, of God filling jars of oil for the widow to live on, as well as raising her son from the dead. And in that account, Elisha also stretches himself out over this child, mouth to mouth, eyes to eyes, and hands to hands. And this is the similar picture that we see Elijah doing this with the Zarephath widow's son. As Elijah is calling out to the Lord, he's laying himself out over the boy. It's recorded that the Lord heard Elijah's cry, and the boy's life returned to him. This is the first example that we see in Scripture of revival from death. Someone being brought from the dead. By all accounts in those days, this boy was declared dead. And I don't think it would do us any good considering that what Elijah did to bring this boy was argued to be some kind of contact magic or even just CPR. This was a miracle. Now, today, granted, I would very much consider the fact that someone being saved from death by CPR a miracle in itself. Quite often it is. But the fact that the boy died and that God restored his life is very significant. It's a very big part in our scripture. The theme of resurrection is weaved throughout the entirety of scripture. It's God's master plan of bringing those who are dead to life, of redeeming his people. It all is pointed to this picture of resurrection. It's also very important for us to note Elijah's actions in this sequence of events. Prayer is powerful. As we said last week, God does amazing things through obedient people. Elijah was a man who was characterized by prayer and faithfulness. It was by prayer that he commanded the rain to stop, and it stopped for 3.5 years. It was by prayer that we see this miracle take place. See, Elijah, he sought to know God's will continually, and he did it in prayer. He aligned himself with God's will, making God's desires the desires of his heart. And as he aligned himself with God's will, Elijah's desires began to be conformed to God's will. Elijah prayed and the boy lived. And now, I'm not saying that every time that we pray, for someone to keep on living, that this is going to happen. Death is inevitable in our world. It's very much still a part of our world because of the presence of sin within it. And prayer isn't the same as having our wishes granted from the genie in the lamp. It's relational conversation with the God in heaven. Continual conversation with God in heaven, asking him that his will would be done on earth as it is in heaven. Once the boy's life had returned to him, Elijah brings him to his mother, and her response gives us some key points to the close of our story in chapter 17. What does she say? She says, "Now I know. Now I know. Now I know that you are a man of God, and that the word of the Lord from your mouth is the truth." It's an interesting response. We've already seen Elijah's declaration, of the word of the Lord come true in verse 16. That the provision of the Lord, of the provision of the food sustaining their life. And then she uses this same title, man of God, in condemnation of Elijah at the death of her son. And now she says again, "Now I know that you are a man of God. Now I know. It took the death of my son and him coming back to life to really show me that you are a man of God and that what you say is the truth." Elijah's actions broke any assumptions that she had regarding this Hebrew foreigner and his God, Yahweh. His deeds displayed the very real faith that he had in God, and also displayed the truth and power of the God that Elijah claimed to follow. He was an example to her. He showed her. And this is not just a response to Elijah, but also to Yahweh. It's a very similar response that Jethro gives, Moses' father-in-law, upon hearing all of the ways that God had rescued the Israelites, and how he brought them through the Red Sea, and how he had protected them from the Egyptians in their escape in Exodus 18. And Jethro says, now I know that the Lord is greater than all other gods, for he did this to those who had treated Israel arrogantly. Well, as the widow points out the truth in the words of the Lord, she's effectively sharing the same sentiment that the God that Elijah speaks for is true. His word is true. He's greater than all other gods. He's greater even than Baal, believed to be the god of rain and therefore the god of life and abundance. No. Yahweh is shown to the widow to not only be the God of provision and rain, but the giver of life itself. And so we see Yahweh get another point in this Baal versus Yahweh saga. Now, I love reading stories of miracles. And I'm sure we all do. And I'm sure that we've all wished that we would get to witness miracles as performed by those of Elijah or Elisha and even Jesus. And sometimes we may even think that a grand miracle in our world, our world just needs a big miracle. They need to see God. God needs to just show himself in some big way, and maybe people would believe, or at least maybe our loved ones, our family members could get to see this in order to get them to see the truth of our God in heaven. Maybe a great sign from God would get them to believe and follow him. Are we looking for signs? Something for us to be aware of today. Are we waiting on a miracle of some kind? What do we think it would take for us to just trust in God's truth and his plan? Do we need God to show us something big? Why is it that it took the widow having her son die and be raised to life for her to really understand and believe in Yahweh? Why couldn't she just see and trust God in the miracle that she was already daily witnessing? That God was providing her life already. Now granted, she had just lost her son. Her son died. That happened. The questions that arise from that kind of grief and loss are only human. At the very start of COVID, as we watched the world begin to shut down, Candace and I lost our first child. Candace was pregnant with our first child, and we discovered at an ultrasound that she had miscarried. And as the world went into lockdown, we didn't care. It was nice, actually, to just get away from the world. The next few weeks were filled with tears and questions much like the one the widow asked of Elijah. But through all of that time, Candace and I recognized the miracles that God had already been working in our lives, seeing how his plan was unfolded as we continually told him yes, as I had followed him to BC, as she had just faithfully stayed at Cornerstone, trusting in him, and seeing wherever he would call us, and seeing the marvelous ways even just in how he had brought us together in our marriage. We knew that even in the most difficult moment of our lives, that God was still good, that God still had a plan, and we could trust him to get us through even this most difficult of time. And it was hard. That didn't change that at all. But I did know I can trust God. He is getting me through this. I don't know how anybody gets through life without him. We could trust him to get us through this difficult time because we already knew that he was providing for us, that he was comforting us in this moment of sorrow. I believe our ability to recognize and trust in God's current miracles and what he's doing right now, his current provision, if we can recognize that and hold on to that, as the psalmist said, I remembered, God, you are the God of miracles. You can get me through this. It helps us to lean into God further, even in the most difficult of moments. We want to see miracles. We want to try to barter with God and propose transactions for miraculous works. God, I'm going to follow you here. If you just show me this, I'll believe you if you just do this in my life. God, I will do whatever you want if you would just answer my prayer and heal this person. Answer my prayer and do this. What is it going to take for you to trust in God and trust in his plan? How big of a miracle are you looking for you to finally say, okay, now I know? And let me be clear, no miracle, no matter how big, is going to change your mind or your behavior unless God does something through you into your heart. Jesus came and performed many miracles, and there were many that doubted and did not believe. And he even performed the greatest miracle that could ever be done. After he submitted his innocent life to being crucified on a cross, he was buried in a tomb for 3 days. It wasn't chance for CPR at that point. On the third day, Jesus rose from the dead. And he went and appeared to many, and first of all his disciples, his closest friends. And Matthew records in 28:17, said, when they saw him, they worshipped him. But some doubted. He's right there in front of you. And Thomas doubted. Some of his disciples doubted. Even when Jesus performed the greatest miracle, some of his closest followers doubted him, though he was standing right in front of them. See, the truth is, you don't need a new miracle to trust in God through your current season. You don't need God to show you something new to get you through today. Because it may come, and you may even doubt it, even if it does. Look for what God is doing in your life right now. Look for the miracles of flour and oil that are currently happening. God's provision, how God is taking care of you right now. Where in your life can you see and credit his love and his kindness? Where in your life have you seen him at work in your life before? Recognize what he has done and he is doing in your life right now. If you want to to reflect on a sign or miracle that God has done for you. Look at what Christ did in dying and giving his life for you, and how he put to death sin itself, and when he gave up his innocent life as a sacrifice, and how he was raised to life on the third day, therefore raising us to life with him. Us. We who were once dead in our sin have been raised to new life in Christ. That miracle has already been done in our own lives if we accept Jesus. And that's a miracle that you can cling to continually, that we have to cling to continually as we put our trust in God. He has redeemed us. See, truth doesn't come from signs and miracles, though. It comes from personally encountering God through the truth of his word. From personally encountering God through prayer. It's through seeking to meet him personally, heart to heart, one-on-one. It's through a personal relationship with Jesus. It requires us to let go of ourselves, let go of our control over our own world, and have faith in something beyond us. I like to think it's the same faith that we have or we don't have, the same trust that we have believing that the earth is round or that we landed on the moon. Now you can believe that or you can choose not to. And it doesn't matter how much evidence is put in front of you, you have to take a step of faith in believing something beyond yourself. We can also learn from Elijah today to it's important to let our faith be on display. That others would know you as a man of God or a woman of God. It's 1 Timothy 6:11 says, "But you, man of God, flee from all this and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, and gentleness." In 2 Timothy 3:17 says, "So that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work." If you follow Christ, Paul says, you are a man or woman of God. Faith without works is dead. So let your deeds show others the faith that is in your heart, that is in your life. Let your works be a display of Christ so that others would see them and say, "Now I know." We've all got to hit that point at some point. We all come to that realization. It doesn't matter what size miracle God shows us, but at some point, we got to come to that realization. Now I know this is God. You are my God. Let others see that through you. Let them have that realization through the light that you give in your life. Also pray. Pray a lot. Like Elijah. Seek God's will. Align yourself to it. God does amazing things through obedient people. Just be in relationship with him. Never stop talking with God. Just, man, the benefits that we have in spending time with our God. And lastly, look for the ways that God is lovingly taking care of you right now. Don't hold out for something bigger. Because what he has done and what he is giving you right now is sufficient. He is sufficient to carry you through. No matter what you're going through and are about to go through, he will carry you through. You can put your trust in him. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you for the life of Elijah. God, and to see his heart, his zeal for you, his passion to just pray, to cry out to you, God, in prayer, in every circumstance. God, that he knew he was with you, continually in prayer, in relationship with you. He knew it was not outside of your will, God, to heal this boy, to bring him back to life. God, and we know that resurrection is not outside of your will for each and every one of us. But we pray that we pray for our loved ones. God, that they would see you, that they would see you through us and say, now I know. God, we pray. We pray for our loved ones. God, that they would also be resurrected, that they would be brought from death to life. Life, God, found in you. In you, Jesus, we thank you. Lord, I just pray, God, that we would look to you, God, to sustain us, to carry us through in the hardest of times right now, whatever that may be. God, help us to look at the miracles you are already doing in our lives, to focus on the provision that you have already given us, the life that you have already given us. God, and to cling to that. We just thank you in your name. Amen. I invite Elliot and Kira to come and close some final song.
Would you stand with us for one last song?
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he would give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of sin.
Just an encouragement for us in our faith, just to remind us not even just of what God is doing in our lives today, but what he has done in so many, in countless others throughout history. It says this, "Now faith is confidence, what we hope for, and assurance of what we do not see. And this is what the ancients were commended for." Over to verse 32. "What more shall I say? I do not have time to tell you about Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, about David and Samuel and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, and gained what was promised, who shut the mouths of lions, quenched the fury of the flames, and escaped the edge of the sword, whose weakness was turned to strength, and who became powerful in battle and routed foreign armies. Women received back their dead, raised to life again. There were others who were tortured, refusing to be released so that they might gain an even better resurrection. Some faced jeers and flogging and even chains and imprisonment, and they were put to death by stoning. They were sawed in two, and they were killed by the sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute, persecuted, and mistreated. The world was not worthy of them. They wandered in deserts and mountains, living in caves and in holes in the ground. And these were all commended for their faith. Yet none of them received what was promised, since God had planned something better for us, so that only together with us would they be made perfect. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart." Amen. This is the word of the Lord. Amen. We're dismissed. We are going to have Sunday school here in about 10 minutes. So if you want to stick around for that, by all means. Yeah. Blessings.